Hi, I'm Julia Munar. I teach at PS8. I teach kindergarten through fifth grade art. I love teaching with contemporary art and showing contemporary art and artists with my elementary students. I believe that teaching with contemporary art broadens students' ideas of what art can be. I like showing my students artists that work with unexpected materials, work in unexpected ways, and I believe that showing children, adults experimenting in their work encourages students to experiment within their work as well. This is a portrait lesson that I taught my fourth graders last year. And when I taught this lesson, I first showed them a wide variety of different types of portraits. And then we experimented with different ways of making portraits. And then this was what they came up with. And all of the work was so different. And I believe that the reason that that was that when you expose children to a wide variety of different types of art, they grow to have the understanding that art is not just one thing, it can be all these different types of things, and everyone's art is going to look a little bit different. So I was really excited to be a part of the Teacher Advisory Committee. I really love talking to other teachers about how they teach. And it was wonderful to look through the teacher resource and come across some artists that I was familiar with and some artists that were new to me. And it was also really fun to write the lesson and then share it and then see how differently everyone approached this task. So I feel like experiences like this are really important because much like how I encourage my students to talk to each other about their art practice, it's important for me as a teacher to talk to other art teachers about my art teaching practice. So after looking through the teacher resource, these were the two works that I was drawn to. I thought that Duan Jianyu's Picnic 1 would be really fun for students to talk about because of these anthropomorphic carrots and this really bright color scheme. And then as I looked through it further, I came across Tang Dewu's Our Children, and I was really excited that this had an anthropomorphic look to it as well. So when I was reflecting on these two pieces, I thought about gesture and how this would be these pieces would be a great starting place for a drawing unit on gesture. So this is a screenshot of Duan Jianyu's Picnic 1. And the way that I shared this with my students was first, I had them make sketchbooks. And then I had this piece up on the screen where it was just the work, no words. And then we viewed it silently first. And then I had the students reflect to these curriculum guide questions in their sketchbooks. So they answered, what do you notice about the poses of the carrots? What might they be doing? Then their sketchbooks, they wrote little stories about them. And then later I revealed to them that the title was Picnic One. And then we talked about, like, does this change anything? Does this help inform anything? And then the students had really lively conversations when they talked about what they wrote in their sketchbooks. And I feel like that's just because this piece was so playful and accessible for the students. So it was really easy for them to talk about and really got their imaginations going. So next you're gonna see a little clip of one of my fourth graders responding to this piece.
The carrots are relaxing at the park, and the picture and the sculpture shows like, oh, they're at the park and they're relaxing. And it's just sort of weird, because imagine you go to a park and you just see a bunch of carrots with legs walking around. So, Yeah.
But you can see, like, super easy for the kids to start talking about this work. So I love sharing it with them. And so this is a screenshot of Tang Dewu's Our Children from the teacher resource. And this touches upon how this work evokes human gestures. So when I showed this work with my students, again, I had the piece up on the screen with no words, and we compared it to Picnic 1. And we discussed, like, how do both of these works feel so alive but have no faces? And then additionally, we wondered, like, what story is this artist trying to tell? Like, what are some clues that we see? Like, in that piece, there's, like, milk and this anthropomorphic table, and the title is Our Children. So, like, we put those together and talked about what story? And then we moved on to our bigger question of how could we make works about everyday objects that feel alive but have no faces? It's really kind of hard to do. So this was the art challenge sheet that I gave to my students. They had to choose one thing from each column, so they might have to make like an onion that is tired or a chair that is angry, and they had to do this with just gestures, no faces. Again, not too easy, but so they worked in their sketchbooks, and they had to do at least 5 different challenges. And then this was where we started talking about titles more. So as they were drawing their responses to this challenge, they also considered what the names could possibly be, and we kept talking about how this is like one more clue that an artist can give to tell a story. And they did a really amazing job on these challenges. So next you're gonna see a video of a student working in a sketchbook.
One lonely paperclip right there. So there's a gang of paperclips over there, and there's one lonely paperclip right here. And I'm the lonely paperclip, and he feels left out from the gang of paperclips.
So yeah, you can really see his thought process and his inventive way of approaching this challenge. So the students chose their favorite of their sketches from the sketchbook to do their final project. So next you're going to see Isabel working on her final project.
It's depressed tape because it's just crying, and the tape is all its tears flowing out of it, and it's just really upset because no one needs more than 2 tape rolls, so he doesn't have any friends. So he's depressed, and he has so many tears of tape.
All right, and next you're going to see Julian working in his sketchbook. Or no, his final copy.
This is like, these 2 clocks are like screaming at each other and failing in a conversation, and this like pencil is kind of scared in the corner because like it's not the best when you're like right next to people like yelling at each other and you're just like right in the corner.
And then Bridget working on her final copy.
So I based this off of bullying because usually the bully has power, which would be the jumbo one in this condition, and the bully would be yelling at the mini one, the one who isn't in power, and that's upsetting the little spray bottle.
So Bridget called her work The Fury, and like I said, that we talked about titles as giving an extra clue. So she felt that calling this piece The Fury would help give the viewer an idea that this work was about a conflict. So the students finished these pieces with outlining with Sharpie, using color pencil, crayons. And these are 2 of the finished pieces. And the students were really proud of these works. It was really challenging to show an idea without spelling it out too much for the viewer. But talking about the titles, Picnic One and Our Children were really great examples for the students. So focusing on the titles really helped the students understand that the title for a work of art could help tell a story. So here are 2 students responding to this challenge.
What I liked about this art challenge is that it let me do stuff that I would normally not do, because I normally draw a more realistic thing, but when we did this, challenge, it let me do something I would normally do, and I actually really liked it. It was really fun for me.
And a student who really likes looking at contemporary art.
It allows you to think in many different ways, like with art, because sometimes people just have this one perspective of art, and it allows them to grow from that perspective and like change their art and make it like stronger.
And I love what he said there. So in addition to creating a new lesson, the curriculum guide also inspired me to bring new life to an old lesson. At my school, each year, the 2nd graders do a big New York City lesson. And in the past, I had done a printmaking lesson where the students created a cityscape. But after coming across Chow Fei's R&B City, in the guide, it inspired me to give a fresh new take on this lesson. So we started the unit by watching an Art21 clip that describes how she created a utopian city. And after we watched it, it got us discussing like what our hopes for the future are. So we made a list on the board of hopes for an ideal city of the future. And after we discussed our hopes as a class, the students broke back up into their table groups, and they had a really large piece of paper. And on that, they responded to these questions. This was the slide I had up on my smart board. And they drew, and they labeled, and they wrote their group's plan for a city of the future. And they focused on the question as a group, how could cities of the future be even better than cities of today? So as they were working in groups, they covered concerns like poverty, the environment, and overcrowded cities, and they came up with inventive ways of solving these problems within their art. So after working as a table group, they had an individual planning sheet, and each kid designed one building, and they were each responsible for one part of the city. And as the students were working, I noticed a shift from years past when I taught this lesson. Because before, students were creating buildings, but now they were bringing an imagined city to life. So the buildings had more detail, and when they spoke with each other about their work, they had like lively conversations, and the buildings themselves were more interesting. So they were really invested in this community aspect. So as they collaged, I saw further the influence of their conversations on city planning and what that did for their work. The fact that everyone was making just one part of the city was really exciting for the kids, and each piece of paper they added to their collages had meaning. So each of these works they created had really in-depth backstories and hopes for the future. Many were based on new technology and ways to preserve and protect the environment. Being a part of the Teacher Advisory Committee was a reminder for me that as an art teacher, it's so important to seek out art that is new to you. Looking at new art inspires new ideas. As a teacher, it's easy to get stuck teaching the same lessons each year and sharing the same artists each year, but exposing yourself to new art gives you a fresh new perspective. The curriculum guide helped me teach a new drawing lesson that had really great questions that was really challenging for my students. It also helped me update an old lesson. I plan to continue to learn about contemporary artists and share them with my students. It's exciting for both me and my students to think about new ways of making art and thinking about art. Thank you.